Well, good morning, folks. Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right, great. Thank you very much, and welcome to the STEM Starter Academy, or the, let me retry this again, I've got too many programs going on. Welcome to our first STEM industry panel for the spring semester. Our panel today is going to be focused on marine science and technology, and we're very excited to have a great group of panelists representing both the sciences and the technology side of the house today. Before I get going, though, I would like to pass the microphone over to President Spraga to do a welcome, and then we'll get everything moving.
Oh, thank you, Meg.
Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to BCC. Some of you are visitors, and others are regulars here at BCC. So it's a great day to promote STEM, which is absolutely one of the highest priorities in the country, and certainly in the Commonwealth. Every time I go to Boston and talk with the governor or the commissioner of higher education, STEM is one of the first things that they talk about. And we have these experts here. I hope you'll be able to take advantage of their expertise and learn. Don't leave today without asking your question, okay? You don't want to be going home saying, gee, it was probably a dumb question or I was too shy. Here are the experts, and they'll help you. At the college, two important things I wanted to mention to you that kind of tie in. We're very playing a leading role with the wind and solar, with wind energy in New Bedford. We're designated the lead training institution for this whole project, and it's going to just really explode in the economy in the next decade, and we're well positioned for that. So this is something that you might want to consider. Also, we're about to, I'm not supposed to tell anyone, but we're about to receive a $4 million grant for life sciences. And again, those areas will be promoted at the college even more than they are now, and they're very well promoted now. So STEM has great possibilities. There's a whole range of activities that are waiting for you to explore, okay? That's what you're here for, and so I'm gonna turn it back over to Megan and welcome you. I can only stay a little while, but I'm gonna be listening up there. I may go into STEM. I'm retiring this year, so I may go into a STEM field. PhD in history didn't do too well. So thank you very much for coming. Welcome again to BCC, and I'm going to turn it back to Megan.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Megan Abella Bowen. I'm the Associate Dean for Science, Technology, Engineering, and Math Initiatives here at the college. And this is one of the programs that we've been trying to highlight each year. We try to bring in about 5 to 6 panels in STEM fields each throughout the course of the year, 2 or 3 in the fall, 2 or 3 in the spring, as a way for students to really connect directly with industry representatives. And so just as President Spray has said today, one of the key things we want to have happen is we would like for you to really take this opportunity to ask questions. These folks are resources here, and one of the things that I think many of them will talk about today is the importance of starting your networking, making connections within industry early on in your career, while you're in high school, while you're in college. These are great opportunities for you to connect up with folks, also to learn what's exactly happening in the field. And I'll just give you a little bit of background on the marine industry. So the New England marine science and technology industry is comprised of approximately 500 marine technology firms. And these companies are located throughout Massachusetts, Rhode Island, Connecticut, New Hampshire, and Maine. The companies employ over 55,000 people and total $7.7 billion in annual sales. And these numbers are actually somewhat old. I'm assuming these numbers have actually increased over the last 5 years. We are seeing incredible growth in this sector. And a lot of it is small startups along with large companies. And basically, there's expected growth. They're expecting high growth in Massachusetts as we continue to move forward. And as President Spraga mentioned, there's a lot of support in the state of Massachusetts to focus on increasing our STEM industries
putting resources and energy behind education to prepare you to go out into the field. And what you're going to hear today is that there's many ways and many access points into the marine technology and the marine science industry. And I think that's really the key takeaway today, is that you can come through and with an associate's degree, you can actually put your foot in the field and get going. You may go ahead and get a bachelor's degree. Some of you may want to go on and get a master's or a PhD. All of those are great opportunities, and they will lead you in many different directions. So with that, I'm going to step back. The way that the panel will go today, just so to give you guys a heads up, we'll do two or three panelists at a time. Each of them will talk for about 12 minutes or so about their background, about their industry. And then after two or three, we'll open it up for questions, because we don't want you to lose the questions that you might have for Tim if we wait and get all the way down to Roger at the end here. And I'll do a brief introduction on each of those, of each of our panelists before we get started. And then secondly, all of you should have received a green handout when you came in. You've got bios on each of these individuals. So again, you can look at that, get some ideas about what they're going to be talking about. And then at the end today, we'll have time for you to ask questions. So if you don't feel comfortable asking a question in a crowd, although I would encourage you to do it because you're probably not the only one with that question, is that also come down here, introduce yourselves to the panelists, and take that opportunity to ask those other questions you may have. So as we get started, I am going to start off with Tim, and I printed it in big print so I could actually read it. Timothy Shanahan is the mechanical engineer and production manager at McLane Research Labs in Falmouth. He is the mechanical engineer, as the mechanical engineer, Tim has been responsible for mechanical design systems, engineering and testing, training and customer support across the McLane product lines. He is also a production manager, and he's been responsible for all aspects of the production process. Tim has over 25 years in the industry. He previously worked at Oasis, an ocean acoustic and instrumentation company, and Acusonic Technologies. Tim earned his Bachelor's of Science in Mechanical Engineering at the University of Massachusetts in Lowell. And with that, Tim, I'm going to pass it over to you.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you guys today. It's a great group, and I'm really pleased to be here. I think these kind of events are certainly beneficial, and McLane has always been a supporter of STEM and science education. A little bit about myself. As Megan mentioned, I work for McLane Research Labs, which is a bit of a misnomer. We don't do research, but we manufacture instrumentation for ocean researchers. Our clients are basic ocean scientists looking at the basics of oceanographic processes. Very detailed studies of ocean currents, ocean biology, sedimentation, ocean chemistry. We have clients across the world, from across the world and pole to pole. We do approximately 50% of our business is international clients. So we have customers that are coming from a great number of systems in Asia, Europe, even in Africa. Scientists that are collaborating across the world with other scientists, and we get a bit of a reach into some extremely important science that's going on today. Our company was founded in 1983 by a Woods Hole oceanographic engineer and a scientist. They started out making an instrument called a sediment trap, which basically is a cone in the ocean that collects the falling sedimentation. And over the years, that's become a staple of that measurement in the industry. It's something we still manufacture today, which is pretty much fit, form, and function, pretty darn close to the original instrument that was developed. We do work with, typically we're working with on the science level, PhD level scientists, PhD candidates, postdocs, basically a number of people that are collecting oceanographic information for different types of projects. We've got, at McLane, we hire a number of different technologies. We have mechanical engineers doing designs, 3D modeling, flow simulations, stress and strain simulations. We've got electrical engineers that are designing circuit cards, integrating other sensors, interfaces, communicating via a number of different technologies, whether it is an inductive communication through a mooring wire or an acoustic modem connected to a surface controller that may be talking via iridium back to shore. We have systems, we have electrical engineers that are doing, as I said, the circuit card design. We manufacture a number of our own designed circuit cards. On the software side of things, we're very software heavy right now. We have a number of software engineers that are doing embedded programming on individual control or small low power controllers, as well as everything up to PC, Linux, and Macintosh applications. So we interface down to the very basic level, all the way up to the user, the scientist. But we're not only just technology jobs. We are technology related, but they are technology related. But as a company of about 20 people, we need to have some salespeople. We need people that are salespeople that may not have a degree in science, but have educated themselves and become experts in their aspects of our applications to aid the customers on the usefulness of our equipment or if our equipment would be appropriate for their particular application. We create all of our own manuals in-house. We've got a technical writer. We create all of our newsletters in-house. We create all of our web application, our website content. All is developed from within, in the building. We've also got technologists for assembly and production. People doing board soldering, people doing wiring harnesses, mechanical assemblies, tests, quality inspections. These are not at engineering level, but at a technologist level. And those are extremely important and difficult to find, we find, in this area. There are certainly opportunities for people that have not started out in the marine industry. Myself, I started out for Acusonic, which was a company that made acoustic flow meters for hydroelectric dams. That got me into a water industry, but not the marine industry. I've worked for a couple other companies since and have been with McLane now for 14 years. But there are certainly opportunities for people that have not started in the marine industry. We recently hired a software engineer who was working for Bank of America, working on internet software and ATM applications, and turns out to be just a fantastic fit in our industry because he adds a number of abilities that we hadn't had before. So there's really not just technology jobs, but there's certainly other support jobs as well that are very, very important. As far as getting into the field, I encourage you to be really diligent about trying to get internships. I get asked a lot about, are you hiring interns? The advice that I could give is to try to find something that you can offer a company, rather than saying, I'll do whatever you want. If you can research what they do, look at the things that they do, talk to people, and see if you can identify a little bit of something that shows that you've looked into what their expertise is and how you could help enhance their expertise or bring some piece of knowledge that's new technology. or propose to educate yourself and the company on new technology. Those are the thing, those are the people that stand out to me as far as identifying candidates for a good internship. So that's about that's what I have, and I certainly welcome all of your questions, and I'd be very happy to answer anything you have today or later on when we break. Thanks very much.
So we'll go ahead and we'll go to our next speaker, and then after Nicole, we will actually take a break. So any questions that you do have from for Tim, please keep those in mind, because we'll come back to that. So our next speaker is Nicole, and pronounce your last name so I don't slaughter it.
Charriere.
So Nicole Charriere is a seagoing biological technician 3 with integrated statistics in Woods Hole. Nicole's responsibilities include sailing approximately 130 to 140 days per year on board federal UNOLS and commercial fishing vessels. She provides leadership on bottom trawl, scallop, you can tell I'm not from Massachusetts, scallops, towed cameras, clam, and other NEFSC surveys, and correctly identifying, weighing, measuring, and biologically sampling various fish invertebrates species from the Mid-Atlantic to the Gulf of Maine and the Canadian waters. Nicole received her Bachelor's of Science in Marine Biology with a minor in English from the University of Rhode Island. With that, Nicole, I'll pass it on. I believe there's a microphone right in front of you.
Great, thank you very much. And thank you to all of you, too, for being here. It's really exciting to see so many people here and to come here and talk to all you guys. I'm really excited. So I, as was said, I received my degree from University of Rhode Island with a degree in marine biology. And the people that I work with, that is, that's not the norm, actually. I'm a biologist. I studied that, but there are people that I work with directly on the surveys. They started in business, and they came out on the surveys as a volunteer, and they just loved it. And they switched careers, basically, and started learning about science. And they came into that, and now they're equipment specialists. And we actually had a student that came through here, basically, that I work with, too. She was a poli-sci major, and she just really loved the idea of coming out to sea and working with the government in the commercial fisheries. So she became a fisheries observer, and now works with me too out on the survey. So there's a lot of diverse backgrounds from where I work, but I just happen to study marine biology. And the English minor that I got to has helped a lot of documentation work that I do at our lab too. So I write a lot of emails, I write a lot of documentation, and it's been actually a real asset to have that kind of writing background. So, and that's not something I ever really expected in the science field, because they teach scientific writing, and then it's kind of like a split where there's like essay writing too. But the two are absolutely combined where I work, and I just thought that was really interesting too. So I've worked with alongside National Marine Fisheries for about 6 years, and I'm a contractor that's employed by a private company to do work with the federal government. And that's something to keep in mind too, that sometimes you'll find when you're job searching that it's very difficult to get a job in the federal government, and contracting is kind of another avenue to keep in mind. The federal government employs a lot of contractors, and there are lots of different job opportunities out there, so just keep that in mind, definitely. And so NOAA Fisheries is responsible for the health and well-being of our nation's oceans, and there are several different fields that are concentrated on, but NOAA Fisheries helps monitor fish populations and kind of ecosystems and protected species and resources. And the work that I do specifically deals with kind of fish monitoring. So I work out on several surveys in the Northeast Center here at National Marine Fisheries. I'm responsible for going out on our bottom trawl survey, which kind of tows big nets along the bottom. I work on our scallop survey, which uses dredges, and our clam survey, which uses dredges. And so I help lead the scientific party at sea. And we collect several sources of data. There's fish lengths that we collect, there's the biology too, whether they're reproducing at the time, what they've been eating, how old they are, all of that we collect at sea. And in order to do that really efficiently and collect great data, we need large teams of scientists to come out on the vessels and do that. And my job is to lead those scientific parties, basically. I'm what they call like a watch chief. So I'm in charge of half of the scientific party, or I'm a chief scientist, which means I'm in charge of the whole scientific party. So I have to be well-versed in all of our protocols. I have to be knowledgeable of the gear that we deploy. I have to know how the ship works and how all the equipment that we bring on board works, how to troubleshoot software. So I wear a lot of different hats. There was no one training that I could do that could prepare me for that. And I love that part about my job so much. I love the variety. I love that I can wake up and not know what my week is going to look like. Unless I'm at sea, and then I'm at sea, so I know what it's going to look like.
Cold and wet.
Yeah, cold and wet. Whoever says that that kind of work is glamorous has lied. So I work 12 hours a day. I work every day. When I'm at sea, that's 84 hours a week. So it's a long day. And I'm covered in fish guts. I stink. And you have to be willing to kind of get down and dirty and, you know, not be glamorous, basically. You know, do some grunt work, heavy lifting, that kind of stuff. But I happen to gravitate toward that kind of stuff. So there are also other scientists that take the data that we collect. We are specifically the spearhead of data collection at our center. Okay? So we collect the data, we audit it, and then we house it basically in databases. And then scientists take that data and they kind of crunch the numbers, they put it in models and figure out fish populations. So there are a whole entire team of scientists working at our center that use our data specifically. So, but I'm just kind of data collection. And what else? I think one of the more interesting things that I didn't learn in school that I absolutely needed for this job is think about the classes that you take, like chemistry and biology and math and you know, computer programming. I think very often when I was growing up, I thought that science was about things like numbers and fish and computers. But nobody ever really prepared me for the idea that in order to do all of that, you need to work with people. And one of the things that I do when I lead the scientific parties is I'm managing people. I'm working with people to try to create cohesive teams. And I felt like I was kind of unprepared that I had to start using that skill a lot. And so that's something I definitely encourage you, is that when you go out into the world, you know, you can be very good at what you do, but the people that I love working with and the people that make the most efficient teams, they're the people, really. They work best in teams, and they work, they know how to bring out the best in people, basically. And I think that's a really highly valuable skill, as much as I kind of didn't want to do that when I was younger. So. And I guess I'll just kind of give you a little background on how I got started here. You know, this has been my job for a long time, but when I graduated college, I didn't kind of know what I wanted to do. Marine biology is a huge field. And when I was an undergrad student, I did an internship where I weighed plankton filters, basically, all day. That's all I did. I gathered data for somebody, and I kind of threw some numbers into some graphs, and I gave it, you know, a paper, and that was my thing. And she invited me back after I graduated and invited me out on a research cruise to collect the data that I had been analyzing, basically. She was like, hey, why don't you come out and, you know, we can go to sea and you can collect plankton. I'm like, great, that sounds awesome. And I actually sailed out of Woods Hole on the RV Nore, which is has now since been decommissioned, but it was for 29 days. And at the end of 29 days, everybody wanted to leave, and I wanted to stay. I was like, oh, this is great. I love being at sea. And two of the kind of technicians that were part of the boat party, they were both women, and I had never really seen that. They were kind of one of the exclusive women out on the boats, and I talked to them, and I was like, you know, what is it that you do, you know? And they were responsible for kind of deploying machines and fixing equipment and really hands-on stuff that I found I loved. And I loved collecting the data. I didn't necessarily like weighing the plankton filters, you know? So I was like, oh, maybe that's an avenue that I should go to. And so I started looking for kind of seagoing jobs, you know, jobs that involve boats and vessels. And National Marine Fisheries at the time was hiring for contractors to kind of just go out on like one trip and test some gear that they needed. So I went out for a week on a boat, on a commercial boat. You know, I had like five people basically. And I kept coming back. I was persisting. You know, I was like, hey, you know, are you doing one of those surveys again? I would really love to come out. And they kept inviting me back, and I kept working really hard, and I talked to a lot of the people in the boats, and I said, what kind of jobs are you guys offering in National Marine Fisheries? And they're like, well, you know, nothing's happening right now, but, you know, keep working, basically. I'm like, okay. So I kept coming out, and there was a point where I was like, you know what, I don't know if I'm going to do this anymore. I don't know if anything's coming of this. And all of a sudden, I got an email that said, you know, hey, we're hiring a contractor to go out to sea on one of our research vessels. You know, not a commercial vessel. It was, you know, the big ones with internet access and 209 feet, that kind of thing. And they basically offered me the position because they knew me, because they were aware of how hard I worked and what I did and who I was as a person and how well I worked with people. So so networking absolutely got me this job that I have right now. And I try to keep that work ethic. What they hired me for, working hard and working well with people and showing leadership skills, I try to demonstrate that every day to make sure that, you know, that I'm proving why I'm here, basically. So yeah, that's pretty much it though. If you have any questions, I'm sure there is about the surveys later, I'd be happy to answer them.
With that, let's go ahead and open it up for questions. So if folks have a question for Tim or for Nicole, just raise your hand. And then if we can't hear them, I may repeat them just because we are taping this, and I know we want to capture that for so it's just not a question out in the middle of air.
Where is McLane place? Where is it physically located?
We're located in Falmouth.
So the question is, how far off the coast do you normally go?
We often operate anywhere from a few miles off the coast all the way to 200 miles offshore. So we kind of work along the continental shelf too, so, but everywhere in between. And we go from Cape Hatteras in the North Carolina area, all Gulf of Maine. So.
Don't be shy. Go ahead.
I used to fish on the south side of Cape Cod. Do you notice tropical species in the summertime? Up in, you know, south of Cape Cod, because that was one of the cool things for me. You know, it's like this physical barrier that fish seem to come up with the warmer temps, possibly even the Gulf Stream. They don't go north of the Cape, but south of the Cape, this stuff this mahi-mahi.
Yeah.
It's a kind of river.
I can answer that question actually just from a diving standpoint. I'm a certified diver and I go diving off of Jamestown, Rhode Island. And absolutely, there are times when you go diving, you see tropical fishes right there. I do believe they follow up the Gulf Stream. And the bottom trawl survey that we operate occurs in the spring and the fall, but there are some surveys that start in the summer where sometimes we do see some tropical fishes in them too. It's awesome. It's really cool. It's nice to see something different too.
And additionally, if you paid attention to the news last fall, there was a manatee that was around in the Cape Cod waters all summer long. My daughter, who's a recent Roger Williams graduate in environmental science, was actually working for the stranding network IFAW, and she was part of the group that retrieved the manatee. And I don't know if anybody followed up on that story, but it turned out that the manatee was pregnant. So they had it tagged, and they're quite interested to see after it's like 12 to 14 month gestation period, what that manatee will do. But yeah, there's a lot of species that are coming where they didn't used to be.
And I think that's the second manatee we've had up here within the last 10 years. Mary? So the question is, can you talk a little bit more about teamwork, how you use it at work, and how you used it in college?
Teamwork actually is something that I got an insight from once at University of UMass Lowell. I was complaining to a professor of mine about how much our fluids class had homework, and our strength of materials class had an exam, and basically, do they load all this stuff on us on purpose? How are we supposed to accomplish all of this stuff? And he said to me, quite honestly, he said, you're supposed to be working with your classmates. If you're struggling with, getting work done, you should be working with others. And that's how we do some things that require teamwork. We'll put together groups of four and make you guys work together. But then there's other things where we expect you to communicate and talk. And talk about answers to questions and work through problems together. Somebody has a skill that's better in one area and somebody grasps another thing. It's definitely how you learn to be on a team. both organically and by assignment in college. At work, it's a critical thing. And personnel and teamwork is a huge issue. Being able to work with others is critical. We have a very, very good group of engineers and people at McLane that I feel very lucky to work with. We don't have many people that are not pulling their weight. And it really does stand out in a small company. So the ability to work with people, seek out opportunities, seek out things that you can take off the plate of your supervisor. Those are the things that make you very valuable in a team. And the other thing is, I guess the other recommendation I have to comment on is that in every job and every new task that I've taken on, I've worried that I wasn't qualified to do it. I've looked at it and said, oh my God, am I gonna be able to do this? Do they know how inexperienced I am in this particular thing? But you get through it, you figure it out, you work with others, you rely on others, and you become an expert. If you can, the best way to stay at a company is to become indispensable, become the expert in something, and then they have to keep you around because you're the person who takes care of that sort of thing, or many things. So that's my comments on teamwork.
Wow, teamwork at Fisheries. Surveys, we conduct 5 surveys where I work, and they start from March until November, so it's all year. In fact, I leave on Monday for one of the surveys. And in order to get them off the dock, I suppose, there's an entire team that needs to make that happen. We have our computer people who get our software ready and get all of our computers on board, and we have to trust that they do their job and they set up the databases right to collect data correctly. Then there's the people that pack supplies for us, people that pack foul weather gear. They bring all that on board too. There's all of us who look over the protocols and make sure that everything is in order and ready to go. People that kind of contact outside investigators to see if they want any samples from the survey too. All of that kind of comes together before we even leave the dock. And we are so interdependent on each other to make sure that every kind of wheel is greased, everything is ready to go. So that when we're actually at sea, everything goes smoothly. And in terms of just scientific teams, when I'm leading, say if I'm the chief scientist, I've learned very quickly you're only as good as your team. You have to do your job, and I do my specific list of duties. But you know, I'm constantly talking with other people on board the vessel, with the captain, with my 2 watch chiefs, basically, who are dealing with their half of the scientific party. How is everything going? Who is doing really well? What are their skill sets? And then you start talking to other people as well, and learning how to, if someone's kind of sitting on the outside, learn how to bring them into the team as well. And like, hey, you have a very specific set of skills, or what can you do really well? And learning, hey, you're actually learning the computer system really well. Maybe you should start doing this. Kind of assigning jobs and learning where people fit into your science team. And like I said, being able to encourage that in people, I think that's a really big thing. Learning, how do people learn? Are they visual learners? Do they need something written down? That part of that is reading people. And it's a major part of teamwork, I think. When you have efficient leaders, they know people's strengths and weaknesses, and they know what people are really good at and what people gravitate towards, what are their interests. And that's a large part of kind of creating a cohesive unit there. And when I was in school, the teamwork that I did I did a lot of labs, and kind of the group work that used to do, where everybody used to get around and kind of dissect a frog. That was the teamwork that I was used to, and one person would have to take notes, and one person would have to maybe cut a ligament or something, and one person would observe, and one person would kind of be gathering supplies or cleaning too. And again, you're learning that every single person was having their job, but if one person slacked, the whole entire team suffered, and conversely, your grade suffered. So So that was my kind of experience being a teamwork, but it's absolutely integral for our work. You know, nobody's an individual where I work. We're all part of a team.
Great.
Well said.
All right, we have one more. We'll take one more question back up here, and then we'll come back and pick them up after the next speaker.
Yeah, I had a question for Nicole. I was just curious, from a research perspective, I've done a lot of work with marine fisheries in Rhode Island, more on the political side of it, and I was just curious, from a research perspective over the years, have you seen a lot of changes within the biomass of the species you're studying and the bycatches?
It fluctuates, definitely. Part of, for example, the bottom trawl survey started in 1963, so there's a lot of data that we've collected over the years. And scientists have been trying to monitor the changes. Since I've started, at least, I've definitely noticed increases in the haddock population. We get a lot of small haddock, juvenile haddock, they're probably about this big. And there have been very large significant catches offshore of them. So haddock's been doing really well. And then on our scallop survey too, I noticed there's some closed areas as well. And when those areas have been closed, the scallop population is extraordinarily dense. So they're doing very well too in those areas. And one of the surveys that I was on too was, there's a closed area right off of kind of Nantucket Lightship closed area, and they just recently added a closed area. And that's because one of our surveys, we discovered scallop seed, basically that big, over 60,000 individuals that was it wasn't thought to be there originally. And so that area is closed off to create kind of a haven for these individuals so that they can grow up. So the haddock and scallop come to mind definitely when I've noticed an increase in biomass for sure.
So we'll move on to our next speaker, but hold on to those other questions because we'll open it up at the end to everybody again. So please don't hesitate. So our next speaker is Eben Franks. Eben is recently retired, but he has nearly 45 years of experience as a sailor, seaman, seagoing technician, geological engineer, geochemist, marine science educator, project manager, underwater vehicle pilot, adventurer, and ocean explorer. So he's kind of done it all. but between 1981 and 2002, he was the manager of the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institute, Stable Isotope Paleoclimate Lab. In 2002, Eben collected the longest sediment core ever taken in the Arctic, more than 65 feet. And he has performed oxygen and carbon analysis using mass spectrometry on approximately 70,000 samples spanning all of the world's oceans. If you've never gone down to Woods Hole and seen the facility that holds all the sediment collections, it's amazing. But Eben also, more recently, was the Director of Solution Support for Liquid Robotics Incorporated in Sunnyvale, California. He's also been an ROV project manager and a sales marketing representative at Deep Sea Systems International Oceaneering in Kadimat, Mass. And Eben received his Bachelor's of Science in Geology from the University of Massachusetts.
Miami.
Miami, sorry. Yes, it's written Miami. So with that, Eben, please.
Thanks, Megan. There's so much accumulated wisdom with what Nicole and Tim have been saying about leadership and teamwork and curiosity and always learning. And the other thing I'd like to touch on while I've got a few minutes is how important it is for students to volunteer their time with civic groups, community groups, educational organizations. We have a couple of wonderful examples right here in the room of people that have really given their time unselfishly. One of them is Kate Tremblay right here. I met Kate 6 or 7 years ago maybe through Megan and Mate RV. When was it?
Probably 6 years ago.
6 years ago. And Kate was volunteering her time with the robotics Mate ROV competition, and subsequent to that, we've had Kate work very closely with STEM Academy on Cape Cod, which is a public school program in Sandwich, Mass. She really poured on the effort getting over to Sandwich from around here to help the robotic students with their underwater vehicle, and that's not a trivial thing. And when Kate was applying to graduate school at SMass, I was more than happy to write very strong letter recommendation for her to get her into SMAST. And that networking that Kate did, meeting other professionals at the STEM Academy Science Advisory Board and working with students in Sandwich and helping us with make ROV over the years, has been a phenomenal springboard for her career now in graduate school. And another example of someone who's volunteering her time is, I was teaching here a year ago, oceanographic technology for a semester, and it was first time I'd ever really taught. I'd done a lot of presentations for school groups, but over the years, probably 500 or so since 1982 presentations, but teaching this course here at BCC was phenomenally rewarding and exciting for me and gratifying, and it allowed me really the freedom to bring in and describe these experiences I had, the people I'd worked with over the years, and one of my students here, Kylie Pasternak, has really put in significant effort in that course last year. And Kylie and I continue to talk. I always say all of my students are now on a worldwide team, a network. People I know in industry and science and business, I'm always more than happy to help people such as Kylie find internships and jobs and other educational opportunities. But to get back to the list that Megan sent around, asking us to describe how we became interested in marine science and technology and all that. Well, I've said many a time when I was a child, I read a lot of books about ocean exploration and lost treasure and shipwrecks and exploration in Brazil, all these people that had done phenomenal things, really challenging themselves to see what's out there, see what's out in the wilderness, out in the ocean, out in the mountains. And I still have some of the books I read when I was 10, 11, 12 years old. And Kylie will tell you I used to bring them to class and hold them up and say, well, you know, this is a book my grandparents gave me when I was 10. And I, a lot of TV programs I watched on Channel 2 when I was 10, 12, 14 years old. But a big turning point when I was young was getting to visit Woods Hole Oceanographic when I was a teenager. And one of my neighbors was a member of the ship's crew, might have been second or third mate at that time on the research ships. He said, you know, Eben, when you're 18, if you want to go to sea, we can get you a job here on the research ship. And having gone through high school, I wasn't ready quite yet to go off to college. I really wanted to get out and see the world. And all these books that I'd read up until that point, and these TV programs I'd seen on Channel 2 about oceans and things that live in the bottom of the ocean, just fascinated me. I said, you know, I'm going to do this for a year. So as soon as I turned 18, I went to the Coast Guard, got my Merchant Mariner's card, a Z card it was called, and went down to Woods Hole Oceanographic with it and talked to the port captain, who was a master mariner. Anybody know what a master mariner is?
It's the guy that's been there forever.
Yeah, pretty much. Okay, a master mariner, and I've never met another one, is someone who is a chief engineer, having worked all the way up through the engine room on ships, and as well as a captain. So he had an unlimited master mariner's license, and this is literally an ancient mariner. This guy was named John Pike, and his voice was just blown out from being in engine rooms for 20 or 30 years and yelling above the noise of these engines. But once I had his name and his phone number, he said, you just let us know when you're available and we'll find something on the ship for you. So I would call Captain Pike every April or May when I was at UMiami down in Florida and say, well, I'm going to be up there middle of June and see if you can find an opportunity for me to go to sea for the summer. So one summer he said, well, Eben,
One of our deckhands was injured in a horseback riding incident in the Azores, and he broke his hip. Can you meet the ship in Bermuda day after tomorrow? And I said, well, okay. So I tear down to Woods Hole and pick up all the mail for the ship and get a plane ticket and get a travel advance and fly out to Bermuda, meet the ship on my 20th birthday that summer, the next summer, in 1974. I'm still a student at UMass studying geology. And he said, we have a ship getting into West Africa next week. You'll need to go to New York to get your visa to get into Senegal. So I went down to New York City a day or two later, hung out down there, went to the embassy, got my Senegalese visa on my passport. There I was on a plane to West Africa. And that was a big project that summer, going across the Atlantic on the Global Atmospheric Research Project, Atlantic Tropical Experiment GATE project. And that's something we studied in our oceanographic technology course last year, the GATE project. And you look it up, the data is still online. It was all typed up and scanned and stuck in these archives, but people have subsequent to that posted it all online. So look up GATE project. It's dozens of ships, dozens of countries, and thousands of people all over the world collecting oceanographic data in 1973, 74, and 75, and I happened to be a deckhand on the ship that summer, going across the Atlantic, stopping in Brazil, and finding our way up and flying home from Barbados after that. I had to get back to school. Subsequent to that, I got hired by U.S. Geological Survey to be a field assistant. I happened to be on the ship in the summer of 75 on the Woods Hole ship. And USGS was on there collecting sediment samples on Georgia's Bank. And since I'd done some sediment coring a couple summers earlier on one of the research vessels, these guys at USGS says, you're getting a degree in geology, you know how to collect cores. When the ship comes in a week or two, just stop by and talk to us, will you? And I went over there, went to US Geological Survey in Woods Hole, and they hired me on the spot for the rest of the summer. And for the next summer, I was making maps and working with these really wonderful, amazing scientific and technical people at USGS and Woods Hole. And after college, I got hired by the oil industry, went offshore, worked on drilling rigs for 3 years in the Gulf off of New Jersey and off of northern Florida. I worked on all the wells in Baltimore Canyon, Wilmington Canyon, and Hudson Canyon off of New Jersey in the 1970s as an engineering geologist. Just by networking, asking where the jobs were, hearing about a big drilling rig that was the biggest, most capable rig in the world, saying, that's where I belong. Well, it turned out that drilling rig, the biggest, most capable drilling rig in the world in 1978, was called the Ocean Ranger. If you look up the drilling rig Ocean Ranger and type in the word disaster, after that, in 1982, that rig was off of Newfoundland in a terrible storm and was lost with all hands. I'd worked on it for 6 or 7 months in 79 and 80 off of New Jersey and knew all these people that went down with it. But there've just been phenomenal opportunities that have come at every turn. And I find that networking, every chance I get, staying on what I refer to as the steep part of the learning curve for my whole life, networking with people like Megan. I've volunteered with Megan doing MATE ROV for many years. And when it turned out there was an opportunity here at BCC to teach this course a year ago, it just was a logical fit. So I encourage each and every one of you to track down things like the Marine Technology Society, MTS. They're always looking for student members, and they've got lots and lots of scholarships, some of which some years go unawarded because people haven't applied. So this Marine Technology Society, there is MARICUS, which is
the Mid-Atlantic region of the Coastal and Ocean Observatory System. Maricus is an educational and research organization that students can join. Likewise, Maricus and Niricus, which is the New England region, these are parts of the Ocean Observatory System. And they have funding for scholarships, for internships, and they are a liaison between educational institutions, research institutions, and fisheries interests, and other commercial interests. So you go to these meetings and you meet just the best people and so many ideas, so many new things to learn about. And every chance I get, I'm involved with these boards and committees and these meetings. And it's just the best networking you can possibly have. And these student memberships are either free or very cheap. Another thing I scribbled here in my notes, how much time have I got, Megan?
About a minute.
Okay. I frequently said, when I go to sea, I can talk with people nonstop for a day, a week, or a month, or 2 or 3 months, and I commonly have. Nicole here talked about mobilizing equipment. I refer to that as heaping and hauling, getting all the stuff piled up and in the containers for cruises. I want to make sure that students here who are looking forward for internships and jobs, look at marinetech.org, marinetech.org, and that's the MATE ROV competition website, but they have about 200 job opportunities and internships listed there all over the world. And if you read those job postings and internship opportunities, you get a very clear idea of what's available out there. Okay, 10 seconds, Evan, got it. I want to make the point that it's important to load up on ideas and be able to read and listen to people and learn from as many people as you can and be able to express your ideas, whether you're writing about it, talking about it, or doing it in a poster or a research paper. And that's like a critical skill to have, just being able to learn about new ideas and express them. So with that, I'm just gonna hand it over for now.
Thank you.
So our next speaker, and I think, I'm hoping, Kate, you will actually maybe be talking about your internship through the MATE program.
Yes.
So just FYI, at the end, I can tell people more about it, but they are currently taking applications for the MATE at Sea internships right now. Kate is a former student that participated. We've had 3 or 4 students at BCC get selected for these, so just something to keep in mind. If you haven't realized, Kate is a former student from BCC. She graduated with an associate's degree in marine science and technology, as well as a certificate in at-sea monitoring. She is currently at UMass in the marine, working on her, I should just read what I have here. Kate is a research assistant at the University of Massachusetts in Dartmouth, working at the School of Marine Science and Technology, SMAST. She studies ocean observation technology, which she plans to use to identify the progression of hypoxia in coastal areas. Her background focuses on the use of ocean robots to gather measurements in the sea. She currently works with Blue, an AUV, which is an autonomously underwater vehicle, at the Ocean Observation Lab, and is one of 2 Northeast CODAR technicians for Maricus. And also, Kate originally came to BCC. She has a Bachelor's of Arts from Rhode Island College, where she received her degree in theater technology.
Thank you, Megan. So this is a different perspective for me, because usually I'm up there looking down on this panel, and it's nifty to be up here because I get to see my various teachers that I've had through the years, and I give you all major kudos because I love my classes here at BCC. I do have plans for a career, but I don't want to necessarily focus on my future career right now as much as I want to focus on what it is like to be a student and trying to get to your goal and the networking involved, like with Eben. I actually started from a whole different industry. I came from theater. I worked in theater technology. So your stage design, your lighting design, totally different. But the thing I can tell you is that I had the ocean itch way back then. So I actually took intro to oceanography while I was pursuing my bachelor's degree. So I can tell you, if you feel like you have like this little nudge in your life that's leading you to a certain path, I'm a great example of like, go for it. I didn't sort of like leave the industry until 2010, and really started, I was like, oh, what am I doing? What's making me happy right now? And it wasn't that job anymore, it wasn't that career. And so I decided I would go back to school, which happened to be here at BCC, and I got my associate's degree. And when you first sort of start a career, you know, you have an idea of how you want it to go, and you have to have just blind faith in yourself that if that's really what you want and that's what you love, you'll get there. It took me about 2.5 years to get through the program here at BCC, and that's already having had, you know, the bachelor's degree. So you got to work on it, and you got to figure out where your losses and your gains are, and drive forward. I did graduate only in December of last year, 2015, and I worked so hard, both with my opportunities and my networking and the people that I kept around me that kept me excited, that it was the first time I got a magna cum laude exit through the school. And I say that because I worked really hard for it. But while I was pursuing classes, I fell into the hands of Megan, who introduced me to Eben, and I've also met Roger Reese as well, and Tim. Nicole, I just met today. But I met all these people as parts of my network through MTS, the Marine Technology Society. And they sort of really helped me feel encouraged about the marine industry and what was going on. And there's just no replacement for that. There's no replacement for the people that you can bounce your energy off of, and they keep you excited. I did get, thanks to MTS, I applied for the Marine Tech internship, and that was in September of 2015. I got to go out to sea for about 2 weeks, and I just sort of got to sit there and watch. And you typically have a 12-hour shift when you're out to sea, and you have two teams of people that switch, and so you either pick the morning and like an overnight morning shift, or the rest of the day to the midnight shift. And I get to go on board and work with Rob Evans from Woods Hole and Carrie Key, who is previously from Scripps. Like, just these awesome, amazing educational institutions for marine education and oceanic research. And we were doing surveys off the coast of New Jersey. And like, I remember when I got the offer in the mail, like saying, you've been offered this internship. And it literally is still like one of the happiest days of my life, because I was so excited to go out to sea. I was like jumping up and down in my kitchen. It was just awesome. And I can say that I wouldn't have had that opportunity if I didn't have my awesome network and the great references that I've gotten. And as well as Robert Rack here, Professor Rack. I've had him for several classes. It was only thanks to him that I got through with my at-sea monitoring certificate, and it really springboarded me towards even more networking opportunities. Prior to the start of this event, we were talking about Tanya Lewandowski, who is also part of NOAA Fisheries, and she actually invited us to come down and participate in part of the active at-sea training that NOAA does, and they took us out on a trawling vessel. It was really quite an experience. So if you find that like you want those opportunities, like don't hold back, go for it. Talk to all the people around you. Eventually, my story leads to me graduating from here, and I got the benefit of going straight into grad school, and it's been such a great opportunity. I work under Professor Dr. Wendell Brown, and he is also a previous grad from the MIT WHOI joint program for like here over in Falmouth, and he was previously, prior to being at SMAS, a professor at UNH. And the funny story about him and why I bring it up is he was actually going to school to be like an astrophysicist, and his advisor was like, you know, oceanography, this is like back in the 1960s and 70s, he's like, is this really cool and exciting field, you should check it out. And so like, if his advisor didn't tell him to do that, he wouldn't be my advisor now. So keep your ear out for the little hints that life gives you. As of now, I get to work with, as we mentioned before, Blue, the AUV, the autonomous underwater vehicle. And we send him on little paths and missions up and down the Mid-Atlantic Bight, so from Cape Hatteras to the Gulf of Maine. And we collect lots of bottom data and top data, because he does what you call a yo. He uses buoyancy to sort of zigzag through the water column. So just having a tool that can do that for you, and it can collect data, it saves a lot of money for research institutions like SMAS to not have to be paying, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars to put these research vessels in the water. But that being said, those vessels are absolutely needed, because when I put my AUV in the water, I still need someone to go out there to do a sample where my AUV was, to sort of quality control my data. And that's a major important thing in any research, is your quality control and what you're doing to make sure that your data is correct. And that's a huge thing in science. You want to have faith in the data that you're putting forward, and faith in the ideas that you're working on. And I plan to focus with the measurements I get from my glider on dissolved oxygen, because a glider has what's called an optode on it, and so it can assess volumes of oxygen saturation. This is all just my springboard of saying, like, the glider is essentially a robot, and it wouldn't exist if you didn't have an electrician, it wouldn't exist if you didn't have a computer programmer. You need the researcher to have the interest in getting the data with the glider, and on top of that, like, you need just people to lift it. It's 120 pounds, I can't lift that by myself. I've had the benefit of deploying Blue twice now, and the second time he happened to get a little bit of a leak, and so then we needed a Fisheries vessel to go out and get our glider for us. So that's all those people, if you build your network now, those are the people who you're going to rely on to help you later when you need your AUV recovered. And I don't want to go on without mentioning Rhonda Moniz, because she's been an absolute asset to me, and she's been so open, and she always wants to get you into the next idea that she's got going on. And I absolutely encourage anyone who's interested in this field to seek out Rhonda and figure out what she's got going on. She absolutely needs more help for MTS. Our MTS group is growing, and there's always positions open, and people, we need to step up to the plate and help with MTS. So, and the other thing I wanted to touch upon is, you had that great question about teamwork. Sometimes the team doesn't just exist. Like you don't form a group in class sometimes until your teacher tells you to form a group. What I can tell you now is that as I'm progressing through my classes in grad school, your team is your end goal, like, because they're gonna be the researchers you're working with, they're gonna be the ones who are crying with you when you're trying to get through your physical oceanography exam. And that's no joke, that exam, I can tell you. And sometimes that team doesn't form unless you take the initiative to start it. And I can tell you, absolutely, the team I started as far as study groups have been the best asset for me. And the team actually, because I had taken the oceanographic technology class when I was here, when we had another teacher who actually, whose position I have now is, his name is Chris Jakubiak. And I actually needed help from the other students from BCC to get me through some of the quizzes and stuff he had in that class. So absolutely, if you don't have a study group for your class and you're struggling, you make it, you get up and you make it and say, I'm meeting here on this day, who's gonna be there with me? And surely if you're just starting out or anytime you're moving forward with those people, they'll continue to be a part of your team and you'll know their strengths and their weaknesses to help you.
Great.
With that, we're gonna go ahead and I'm just gonna move on to Roger, because actually Kate led right into him when talking about the AUVs and the folks who actually work on the equipment. And then we'll open it up for questions. And I know some of you may need to leave for class, so we understand that. So if you need to get up and leave, that's fine. So let me just give you a little bit of background on Roger and then get Roger going. So Roger Race is the Maritime Innovation Program Developer at Boston Engineering. As a maritime innovation program developer, he is creating innovative solutions to critical problems and leveraging new technologies to provide better value for all Boston Engineering customers in the marine and underwater world. Roger was a program executive at Rolls-Royce Marine and the general manager and chief engineer at Brooks Ocean Technology USA. He was responsible for the startup of the company in 2005, and he has several patents with underwater devices that he uses. And then basically, prior to creating the successful company, Brooks Ocean Technology, Roger was a senior engineer and director at the Marion, Massachusetts office of Yellow Springs Instruments, where he was part of a team that integrated numerous water quality sensors and instruments onto the HUI Remus unmanned underwater vehicle and the ocean server IVER UUV. Roger holds a degree in marine biology and mechanical engineering.
Thank you very much, Megan. It's a pleasure to be here, and I'm really great to see this, so many folks who are interested in the marine field. I want to chunk it back up and just say we do live on a blue planet. It shouldn't be called Earth. It should be called water. I also want to reiterate what you had said earlier, Megan, that with 500 marine tech firms here and employing over 55,000 people, this is a multi-billion dollar industry, and there are lots of opportunities from Rhode Island, Connecticut, right through Cape Cod and up to New Hampshire. This triangle that we all live in is a wonderful place to work, and there's lots and lots of opportunities for all different types of folks. My personal career has been varied and tacking back and forth, but basically what I wanted to, my notes, everybody said great stuff this morning. My notes are absolutely you have to work in teams these days, and you have to have cross-pollinization of ideas. My background in biology and mechanical engineering has led us at Boston Engineering. We have designed and built a underwater vehicle that is based on a bluefin tuna, so using biomimetics to create an underwater vehicle to swim just like a fish would. But on board that vehicle are sensors from a variety of companies around. Teledyne, Hydroid has got some stuff we've got. And it's just wonderful to be in this area and having not only our own little teams, but I would say chunking it up, teams of companies that work together. Everybody is very friendly in this marine tech environment. It's a great place to work. And once you get into this sort of club, you see the same folks all over the place, whether you're in Hawaii or in Australia or over in Europe. It's a good bunch of people. One of the things that I do like right now is we are experiencing all kinds of robotic systems being created, from small little tiny UUVs to gliders to biomimetics, And it's a wonderful time to be out and playing with instrumentation. We have more power on chips. I'm sure everybody has a cell phone here. There's more power in your cell phone than the first moon rocket that NASA put up in the 60s. It's just a wonderful environment to play in. It's a wonderful environment. If you like the water, you would really enjoy being in this field. And it could be any level you want to, in any degree you want to, because there's lots of opportunity from the bottom in geology to the water column, to the air and atmosphere interference. It's great. It's a wonderful place to be.
You're
going to
leave it that simple.
I'm going to leave it that simple because I'm sure there are lots of questions. All right.
Well, that's great then. So we've got quite a bit of time for questions. So now it's opened up to any of the folks on the panel. So please feel free to go ahead. And do I have anybody who wants to have a question? If not, go ahead.
Probably I'll just make a general comment to people about what some of these panelists have said. One thing, don't sell yourself short, for one thing. Because, and one thing, you have to, if you want it, you go after it. You know, people aren't going to be there, oh, come on here. No, you generally have to go there. I remember when I was in college, I filled out an application to work at the National Marine Fisheries Service. Well, I didn't know anybody down there. I didn't know anything. I said, "Oh, there's an application." I filled it out, and I had good grades and stuff like that. And I got a call. I was working for my parish, scraping the fences and stuff for the summer, and stuff on the wrought iron fences and stuff. And they got a call and said, "You run work for us, and for the summer." And so I went down there, and this was in 1977. Age myself. And so I went down there and I worked for the summer down at the aquarium. I worked there actually for four summers. This is my junior and senior year in college, and then when I was going for my master's degree, my 2 years there. And then once I finished my coursework, then I was worked as a research for the resource assessments division down there. And I was deep sea scallops was my area that I was working with. And one thing unfortunately at the time, but I was a victim of Ronald Reagan's federal hiring freeze.
You too.
Right now, I was told in the morning that I would be hired, and they were doing the paperwork, but the paperwork wasn't done until the hiring freeze was imposed. But one thing I always, one door closes, another door opens, and that's the way you have to always look at things, be open and be flexible. Because I initially wanted to be a freshwater biologist, but then after going down, working in Woods Hole and everything, I worked as a I had the opportunities to go out on foreign vessels. Also, I was a watch chief and one of the things. And I was the youngest person on the team. So the team, and I was a watch chief. But you know, this is where teamwork works together, and everybody works together on the project. And you know, age didn't matter. You know, it wasn't working on a thing. And so it's something to you know, if you want it, go after it, but always be willing to. Look for where the doors are and look for the open doors.
I've got a couple of quick comments.
Well, I was going to ask one question of Kate,
okay.
I'm going to kind of
sure.
put her on the spot.
Yep.
Kate, how many times did you apply for the at-sea internship with Nate?
I think three times.
Three times. And so I want you to hear that because Kate never gave up. She just kept going back and saying, you know what, this is what I want to do. I want that opportunity. And each time, I will say, with the Mate internships, different years, they're doing different things. Some years, they want computer scientists because they need somebody who can actually take all the data and deal with that. Some years, they're going to need somebody who's more of an electrical engineer because they're going to actually be working on a lot of instrumentation. So each year, it may change. But Kate never gave up. She kept persevering through, and it led to that opportunity. So I just want to kind of reiterate that.
Sure. The more interesting about it is that as the season progresses in Mate, they have ships that become available and then get filled and become available. And I didn't even find, like normally you would know by May if you were getting an internship, and I didn't find out until July. So I had already stopped myself. I was like, all right, I'm not getting it this year. And then I got that letter and it was just like, oh yes.
Well, there are a whole bunch of things I want to add. One thing Roger said about teams of companies working together and integrating instrumentation and robotic vehicles and telemetry and all that. it reminded me of a project where there were four companies doing demonstrations for the Army Corps of Engineers in West Virginia. We were using these underwater robotic vehicles, ROVs, in a dam complex to go inside of these dams and look at valves and 800 feet inside of a lock to see how a seal was working on these big doors that open and close to allow the water to rise and fall in the lock. And during that week, it's fiercely competitive. These four companies were, I'm trying to remember, it was Video Ray, Teledyne Benthos, Seabotics, and one other newcomer. But we were all helping each other launch and recover the vehicles, and going to lunch together and having dinner and drinks after work each day. And we all get to be great friends, even though we were all competing for that one big contract. And that was an important point. And that reminded me of what, you ever know Bill Charbonneau?
Yeah, sure.
Oh, what Bill Charbonneau always said, there are no competitors in this industry, only future employers. And I thought that was just a wonderful shred of wisdom. And another thing that I wanted to bring up was how important it is to grab the initiative and look beyond your field of study and the things you're actually working on. Kylie Pasternak and I here have talked about her just taking it upon herself to read up on acoustic modems and acoustic data telemetry in the water. It's a fascinating subject, and something Roger and I talked about here earlier today, how important it is that underwater vehicles are able to communicate back to the surface and to the, whether it's a ship or a satellite or a buoy, and get the data back. And acoustic modems and acoustic data telemetry are really important things to understand, and it's a manageable set of things to learn about. And if you learn about it, study it on your own, and you can go into the opportunity for a job interview, an internship, something like that will really set you apart from all the other engineering students. If you understand acoustic modems and sending data through the water, what the frequency is and how much data you can crunch through a data channel in the water column, how far it'll be transmitted. And the other thing quickly that Bob mentioned was that hiring freeze of 1980. After working on offshore oil and gas drilling rigs for 3 years and seeing helicopters crash and wells blow out and all sorts of mayhem, I said, geez, you know, I think I'm going to go back to Woods Hole and see if I can get rehired by U.S. Geological Survey. So in the summer of 1980, I went back there, filled out the paperwork, and was marching towards being hired in November by U.S. Geological Survey as a geological tech. And the very day that I was getting rehired by USGS in Woods Hole, Ronald Reagan gets into office and he says, hiring freeze, boom, that job evaporated in a moment. And they said, well, you know, why don't you go next door to Woods Hole Oceanographic and see what they have in the core lab? Well, they had just posted a job in the WHOI core lab that we visited with our oceanographic tech class in 1980, and it was written for another guy whom I never met, but his qualifications were the job description. And when I walked in there, having been to sea on Woods Hole ships, having collected deep sea sediment cores, and having worked with a guy named Cesare Emiliani doing paleoclimate research at UMiami, I was more qualified than they wrote the job description for than the other guy. So I got that job right off the bat. And literally, within a couple of days, that door at U.S. Geological Survey closed and this other one at Woods Hole opened right up. And I stayed there for 22 or 23 more years.
And I'm going to cut you off right there.
Yes.
Only because I do know we have a class that's going to come in at 11, but I want to ask Roger and Tim if you'd answer this kind of question. And then when we finish, we'll meet outside just so I can clear the room for the next class.
Sure.
But we'll be around, so if folks have questions, please don't hesitate to come up and ask. But the question I have for both Tim and Roger is, you both work with companies that cover a large variety of types of folks that work in there. I mean, your whole title is innovation and where that next step is. You guys are doing a lot of environmental sampling, so not only do you meet the technicians who are designing and all that, where do you see the growth opportunities, or where do you see how students today ought to be thinking about that next step, and how do they not pigeonhole themselves?
That's a great question. I wouldn't worry about pigeonholing now, because I think if you're a curious person and have just an interest in the water, you'll find that there are all kinds of opportunities, whether it's a technician, a scientist, or an engineer. Right now at Boston Engineering, all of our teams would incorporate a mechanical engineer, electrical engineer, software engineer, systems engineer, and probably the most fun right now is we have three rapid prototyping machines. So we design and build everything on a rapid prototype machine first before we even think about building the real thing. So that's one area that's really sort of exciting that didn't exist back when I was going to college, is having all this wonderful rapid prototyping available to us all right now.
Great.
Okay. I guess I would say to be open to things that might not seem directly in your expertise or your direct interest for what you might see your career to be. I know dozens of people that are in this industry that had no training at all in this industry. I know people that have marine biology degrees that are working in completely different fields, because as you may know, or hopefully you know, some of the marine biology fields are a difficult road to go. A lot of times, there's certainly a lot of unpaid internships out there, and you might have to struggle through a bunch of those to get to finally get onto a position. But be open to things that you may be able to leverage some of the information or some of the education that you have to utilize that in a field that is not directly related to what you're doing. For example, we manufacture equipment for marine biologists and physical oceanographers, but we don't employ a scientist. We don't have anybody with really much marine biology experience. Somebody with a marine biology background that has skills in electronics, communicating with instruments, some field work, those sort of things might really, you know, be useful to a company that doesn't have those direct skills. So be open to things that you could use your experience in a different way.
And with that, we are going to go ahead and wrap it up. I'd like to have a round of applause for our speaker today. We'll be just outside the door here, so that if you guys have questions, please feel free to go continue your conversations with these folks. And I will tell you that our next panel will be Monday, April 3rd at 9:30, and that's going to be a Women in STEM. So we'll have folks with science, technology, engineering, and math. It's open to everybody, but there'll be women talking about their...